you start with Echo. You don't hear as much about Echo, which is ironic, actually. Echo's standing on the platform of a railway station at the foot of a range of mountains which tower over her town, tannoy in hand and high-vis velcroed over her uniform. She's perpetually scribbling onto a clipboard with what can only be described as a chaotic amount of paper attached to it. Delays, disruptions and changes of schedule are written and rewritten over the original timetable with an increasing amount of creative annotation to account for the decreasing amount of blank page real estate available to her. Echo clasps this illegible oracle of a clipboard to her chest. The station is just on the cusp of where the man-made is handed off to the wilds of nature. Some great beautiful beyond behind the walls of the town with only the train track daring to trespass. The journey from Attica through the mountain range along cliff edges, swallowed by valleys and among untamed woodland is breathtaking. The guard says that there's this remarkable moment when the train first pulls out from the gorge and into the open valley where, without fail, a weighty hush falls over the carriage. All of the travellers wordlessly agree on a ritual to show reverence to this most sacred vision. It's not often as tangible as this, all of this wild authority. Humans aren't cut out for this bullshit. And if they think they are, then they're rolling the dice. They're taking the piss. They know they are messing with the big boys. There's a theory that the contours of the landscape that surround a person will inform and characterise their voice. That the geography of our home will shape the way we speak, literally alter the sounds of our vowels and the texture and attack of our consonants. The way accents develop is no accident, it's a response to the flat plains or the high seas, jagged cliffs or rolling hills. The way we communicate with the world is a reflection etched by the way the world communicates with us. And she is. The main thing you should know about Echo is that she is fucking captivating. She could talk about anything. She could talk about the shipping forecast and end up articulating the soothing nostalgia in your mother washing the shampoo out of your eyes at bath time, or the strange newness of a dry-cleaned old suit as compared to the bittersweet solace in realising it's the first time you've laughed since your heart has been broken. She may never have finished a story in her life, but at dinner, she's probably started 10 before she's even taken a bite. And you can't take your eyes off of her. And if you do, it's just because you've had to close them to listen to her voice. Because her voice is beautiful. It treads so gently with empathy. It aches with hope. It's fired with compassion and strength, it pulls all who hear her along in the rhythm of her heart and the beat of her breath on the air. Echo is solely responsible for making the train station announcements. She does so via a tannoy. She spices up the delays or cancelled trains with stories, poetry, commute haikus, a page of a favourite book pulled straight from childhood and broadcast bright and early out to the platform of cold commuters cradling their coffee in thick mittens. A few years ago, the press caught whispers of this unlikely train station orator and Echo was invited to hold counsel with her idols. The posters on her adolescent bedroom walls made real. She had gained counsel with the gods. Zeus, Aphrodite, Artemis, Apollo, Dionysus. Each god is an absolute vision. More divine and lovely than Echo had ever imagined. But best of all, Hera. They say never meet your heroes, but Hera exceeds all expectations. And after a few meetings, it's clear that Hera admires Echo. And if Hera likes you, then you keep getting invited back. But nothing is infinite. These things come to an end. The invitations to Mount Olympus stop. After her brief brush with the gods, her life returns to normal. It is a remarkable chapter that Echo cherishes. A lot of time has passed now since those impossible days, but Echo holds on to what Hera had told her. That her impact couldn't possibly be measured in time, it would be measured in joy. There's a woman on the platform with a big box, a perfectly inconvenient size, extremely heavy, about the size of your average door. The most effective way to haul the box, as this woman has established through an undignified trial and error, is a sort of upright hug and shuffle. Echo has not clocked this. She's briskly gliding down the steps of the footbridge as the woman shuffles towards the stairway. And Echo collides with the woman at some speed. The oversized box makes a bid for freedom, flipping on its end like a caber having just been expertly tossed before slamming definitively onto the concrete platform. An additional loud sound accompanies the solid thud. It's a distinctively shattery sound. Echo looks up at the statuesque woman. She recognises her immediately. Hera, queen of the gods. Words do not often fail Echo, but when they do, she has this sort of out-of-body experience where she barely recognises herself. She fumbles with the box, opening the end to see if the contents are salvageable.
It's a mirror.
Not anymore.
It's still a mirror.
Look, let me...
For God's sake, don't offer to pay for it.
Let me get you a coffee. Hera turns and walks to the station coffee shop. Her relief at no longer being encumbered by the box is frankly palpable. Hera is a woman who revels in the bliss of cutting her losses. There's a nihilistic thrill in her clinical ability to turn her back on the things that she cares about the moment that they burden her. And Echo can't work out if that is enviable or absolutely sociopathic. Hera sits beside the huge double-height glass wall looking out onto the platform. It's a two-way mirror. She likes sitting here because people use the other side to check their reflection as they set out on their journeys, ignorant to who might be looking back, ignorant to how close they might be. A young man sets down his suitcase on the other side of the glass. Echo brings two coffees to their table. The young man has unpacked a well-worn sketchbook and a pencil case. When he looks up at the glass again, he locks eyes with Echo. He is oblivious to this, of course. Echo sits down with Hera. I should preface this section by saying that Zeus, Hera's husband, is awful. And she's had enough. It's unbelievable, actually, that a woman this impressive should have ever endured such a monumental arsehole to begin with.
Do you know why he stopped inviting you?
Echo doesn't know. And she's not sure that she wants to know, actually. She thought they were going to talk about the mirror that she just broke. This is a surprising opening to the conversation that, it's fair to say, Echo's feeling uneasy about.
It was me. I asked him to stop inviting you.
Echo definitely preferred the narrative where she blissfully never once questioned whether she might have done something to offend her favourite god.
You were a distraction. Zeus found someone that captivated me more than he did, and it worked.
While Hera was enthralled with Echo, Zeus took the opportunity to get wrapped up in lots of other people.
It all stopped. I made it all stop. The dinner parties, the entertainment, the friends, the good wine, the food. Every bit of that happiness was tainted. I didn't realise it was possible to retrospectively extract the joy from something, but it is. You know, it breaks my heart that when I heard your voice today, all I felt was that same pain, fresh, washing over me again. Don't worry about the mirror.
Echo is horrified that she's so embedded in Hera's pain, and she knows she's not responsible. Hera has never suggested that anyone other than Zeus is responsible, but Echo has this feeling of slow burning adjacent guilt. Hera's train pulls up. She hugs Echo, and she leaves. Echo is immobile, stunned into stillness. This all happened too quickly for her to process. What she had previously understood to be true has all of a sudden had a drastic redraft. Now she's standing at work, unexpectedly burdened with Hera's broken belongings. She needs to make the announcement for the train over the tannoy, but she doesn't quite have it in her. Her breath has dropped out like a sinkhole has opened up below her throat. Sue from the ticket office scurries up beside her with an expectant look on her face. She gestures to the tannoy.
9:37, express, ready to depart.
Echo breaks from her trance long enough to muster some energy to repeat after Sue.
9:37 Express, ready to depart.
The boy with the sketchbook jumps up with a start, bounds across the footbridge and hops onto the train too. Echo can't stomach hearing her voice blaring through that tannoy all afternoon. Sue does the rest of the announcements today. Echo takes the broken mirror home in a taxi that she can't afford.
The thing Echo values most, above all else, is now inextricably linked to someone else's pain. Echo is rational, she knows it's beyond her control. She is logical, she knows it can't be undone, but the thing that's churning deep down is the question of whether she is selfish to feel hurt by what has just happened.
She barely says a word the rest of the day. She stays in bed for the weekend, and on Monday, she takes 2 weeks of her annual holiday, too ashamed to say that she can no longer bear the sound of her own voice. That the idea of being amplified makes her want to fade.
She sits in her bedroom, surrounded by the pieces of Hera's broken mirror, and in an effort to feel like she's doing something, piece by piece, she begins gluing it back together. I don't know if you've tried gluing a shattered mirror back together. It is possible to bring together the broken pieces in the way they were previously arranged, but that doesn't solve the problem. As the days pass, Echo's voice shrinks, and with the loss of the thing she treasured most, she tries very hard to find value in the other parts of herself. But instead, she notices the flaws in the things she had never questioned. She not only begins to miss what she had, but hate what she has. The quieter she gets, the more she fears she'll simply disappear.
When she returns to work, she has to relinquish the announcements. Now, Sue from the ticket office has sole use of the tannoy.
Echo sits at the information desk. It's more manageable, it's low pressure, simply repeating back the information about the day's trains, leaving her post once a day to clean the tall glass mirrored walls. The young man is back regularly, sitting on his suitcase on the platform, sketching what he sees. Sometimes he'll get so distracted he'll miss his train, but he doesn't seem too bothered by this. She watches him attentively gazing across the tracks to the mirrored wall. She spends weeks wondering what he sketches. Her curiosity is at fever pitch, but she doesn't possess the courage to ask outright.
And there is clarity in the realisation that something which once came so easily to her now seems impossible. Some quiet chaos has consumed her. She, a powerful creature, has retreated into a fragile thing, unsure of her footing at every step, eroding away slowly until the articulate animal within her is nearly wordless. Echo is rarely able to speak now. All she can manage is to repeat back the last words she's just heard. At 9:30 a.m. the following Monday morning, the boy sits waiting for his train. As it pulls in, he fumbles for his bags, and in his haste, he mistakenly leaves his sketchbook behind. Echo collects it from the ground.
Every page is a self-portrait, with a date scribbled in the corner. Each and every day, the fresh face of a young man sat on a suitcase at a railway station. Echo sits at the information desk with the lost property box prominently displayed on the countertop.
And she waits, because surely someday soon he will reappear. He'll retrace his steps to reclaim the sketchbook. This dedicated affection that he affords himself is something that Echo recognises from a past version of herself.
What she wouldn't give to be in love with her voice again. As she waits, she begins drawing herself on a stack of post-it notes. Simple line drawings at first to pass the time. But as the hours tick on, her scribbles find more details. She peels another post-it off, slaps it on the back cover of her clipboard, starts again. It begins as an exercise, to remind herself that she exists. It becomes an experiment, to see if she can reclaim the parts of herself that she has lost. It transforms into a ritual, to fall back in love with who she is.
After 1 week, she has scribbled over 200 post-it-sized portraits, which, considering she has a full-time job, is quite impressive. At 9:30 a.m. on Monday morning, a young man arrives at the information counter. She recognises him straight away. His eyes are fixed on the sketchbook in the lost property box.
Hello.
Hello.
Is it all right if I have a look? Echo hands over the book. He thumbs open the first page. Yeah, it's mine. I lost it last week. Look, it's me. He holds it up over his own face. Can I take it? Take it, yeah? Yeah. You don't need any proof or...
She shakes her head. He takes the sketchbook and nestles it safely back in his bag. He clocks the post-it note portrait smothering Echo's clipboard. And for the first time in the interaction, he properly looks up at her face, allowing himself a moment to examine each of her features before looking back to the chaotic post-its. You could argue that this boy is quite oblivious and quite self-absorbed, but he is good at recognising himself in others, which isn't without its benefits. He offers her a nod of solidarity and a reassuring smile. He hears her and she sees him. Neither say a word. His train pulls into the station and, as is customary, he is caught completely off guard.
Shit. Goodbye. Thank you. Echo spends the next 7 days using the hours at work to feverishly scribble more pictures of her face and the hours at home to painstakingly continue gluing the mirror back together. Until Monday morning, when 9:30 a.m. rolls around again. It is a breathtaking morning. He's there again, sitting on his suitcase, pencil in hand.
And she's going to thank him. That's the plan. Easy. It's important, because the self-portraits, they've been the only healing thing that have begun to tether Echo back to herself. She's not taking any risks. Should her voice fail her, she's armed with a stack of post-it notes and a pen.
The station is busy this morning. The train rolls in and she still can't see him. The people swarm towards the doors, draining from the platform. The whistle goes, but this feels important today. It feels necessary today. In fact, it feels so vital that her breath tightens and fight or flight kicks in. She jumps aboard and the guard slams the doors closed. And slowly, the train pulls away into the tall rock walls of the mountains.
Echo probably should have warned Sue before ducking out for the next few hours, but c'est la vie, here she is.
She's in the first carriage. He isn't here. She begins moving down through the train as it climbs gradually up through the mountain passes. As she reaches the middle of the train, she can see him at the end of the carriage beside the door, sketchbook open, using the faint reflection of the glass to etch out the lines and contours of his face today.
Echo does not, at this point, miraculously find her voice and thank him. So she leans on the window at her end of the carriage and begins to write a message of gratitude onto a series of post-it notes, trying hard to articulate herself succinctly because... post-it notes.
The train abruptly shunts to a standstill. His pencil careers across the page. Echo barges into a woman with a buggy. There's an announcement.
Sorry for the delay. We've got a technical fault. We're just going to roll forwards out of the gorge to give our engineer a little bit more space, and we should be on our way soon enough.
The train slowly pulls forwards, out from the tall rocky walls it has been travelling between and into the valley. The disgruntled passengers are temporarily alleviated by the sight of the wild and the shafts of golden light cutting in through the windows.
As an hour passes, the coach becomes more restless. Echo, now with ample opportunity on her hands, still has not approached him. He remains absorbed in the drawing. They hit 2 hours.
Sorry again for this delay. We're now waiting for another engineer who has the parts needed. He's expected to arrive in the next 45 minutes or so.
The young man looks to the window again, but this time his eye is caught by something beyond his reflection. Impatient and impulsive, he reaches his hand through the window, opens the door and hops off the train. There's just something irresistible in all of this wild authority. Plus the train, he reasons, is not going anywhere for ages.
And as with all commuters, everybody minds their own business. Echo has been watching, and in a split-second decision, mimics his action and hops down out of the train.
He's already set out towards something in the distance. Echo looks up toward the front of the train. She sees the guard, the driver and the engineer sitting on camping chairs, drinking from flasks on the grassy mound behind the camp. This train, she reasons, is not going anywhere for ages. She follows the boy. He's just far enough ahead that she can't quite catch up. And if she could just catch her voice, he would hear her call out. But all she has is an echo and it is still and silent out here. So she silently follows. Because somehow this mission has become important. Because if she starts something, she has to finish it. Because this task has given her purpose. Because if she says thank you, she reasons, That makes this healing tangible.
And truthfully, I don't think that her healing lives or dies with him. I think the fact that she has found closure in some other form is what could allow her to find herself again.
The longer this walk winds into the glades, the more fixated she becomes on the reward. She has begun to believe that this, and this alone, will repair her.
Even if it went perfectly to plan, I don't think that's true. But I want her to heal, and I want her to feel better, so if this will heal her, who am I to judge? And he seems like a good person, but he is entirely oblivious to the impact that he's had.
He stops. A body of silver water enclosed by a forest, framed by the mountains, glistening in the mid-morning sun. It is so still. The surface like polished glass. The low branches of a fallen ancient tree reach out across the lake. He climbs into the arms of the tree to get a better view until he is way out over the water. He steadies himself, sits down, pulls out his sketchbook and starts drawing.
And believing he's in the comfort of his own company, he marvels at what he sees. He knows he's good looking, but this reflection is astonishing.
You are beautiful. And before she can catch her tongue, you are beautiful. Is anyone there? Is anyone there? Yes, yes!
Echo, with no other option, timidly approaches through the trees. There's a moment where he takes his time to stack up what exactly is going on, if this whole situation is fucking weird. But you sign a contract for that when you do something weird, like storming off into the wilderness when your train breaks down. He does recall meeting her, and a feeling of immediate empathy.
You're from the train station. Yeah, I remember you. I remember you. Did you follow me? Follow me? Echo is humiliated and exposed and tortured by how she thought this would play out versus how it's going. Her voice has not miraculously come back. In fact, here, it is more amplified and visible than ever. She can't hide behind the desk or the crowds or the noise. The silence and the stillness is making it worse. It's magnified. Her words are just echoes, and she's ashamed because she feels insane right now and she cannot help it. She can't even explain. It's okay. It's okay.
She fumbles for her post-it notes, but they feel stupid now anyway. She's too embarrassed to show him what they say. And Echo, a woman who rarely cries, cannot stop the tears tumbling from her cheeks, causing delicate ripples in the silvery lake.
He glances back at his reflection, distorting in the water disturbed by her tears, and he feels selfish, but for a moment he's captivated again because there's some beauty in the distortion. And there's some story in the significance of those tears. When you look at somebody's face, you do not see the whole face at once. Our attention darts from their eyes to their mouth to the minute detail in a wisp of their hair or the curve of their jawline. The moment we change our perspective, this all shifts again, but it's still the same face. When painting a portrait, the truly great do not replicate what they see. They construct what it is to experience that face from their own unique point of view. He loses his footing and drops his sketchbook into the water. Without a second thought, he dives after it, through his reflection on the surface and into the deep water below.
In an emergency, it is not always immediately obvious that you're bearing witness to a life-threatening crisis.
He does not surface immediately. He does not surface for some time. Echo wades into the water, the bottom of the lake drops out below her. It's deep here. And the point where he dove is further out still. She swims frantically across to where the water is still unsettled from his body cutting into it. He still has not surfaced. The silence and the stillness do not match up to the panic and the terror of what has happened. He still has not surfaced. The sketchbook bobs to the surface.
If you cannot see beneath the water, you should never jump in.
His jacket had caught on one of the branches submerged low in the water. He can't free himself, and slowly the air in his lungs is replaced by the tranquil, beautiful, silvery water of the lake.
Echo sits, still, stunned, silent, bereft at the water's edge. Guilt on guilt on guilt. Pain on pain on pain. I wish that I could say that after she left here, she found a way to heal, but she didn't. In fact, she never left.
Even the energy to move was too unbearable, and the silence made it worse. By the time she had lost count of the days, she had begun to wither away, sat in the same spot until she turned entirely to dust, leaving nothing but her voice.
To this day, Echo's voice still calls back from valleys, caves, and lonely places, repeating the last spoken words, forever.